My name is Ben Amtaebi. I'm with the Group of Philosophy at Delft University. In today's talk, I will present the case of nuclear energy production and values at stake in the production of nuclear power. Today's talk consists of two parts. In part one, I will present an analysis of several values at stake when we are producing nuclear energy in what is called a nuclear fuel cycle. This is called an ex post analysis, an analysis of an already existing technology. The second part of the talk is about an ex ante analysis. That is an analysis of a technology that not yet exists. That is actually the more important analysis for the discussion of responsible innovation, in which we try to accommodate the values prior and during the development of new technology. Let me start with the first talk. The presentation of today consists of, the first presentation will consist of the following sections. I'll first present to you sustainability as an ethical framework. I will then move on and present five key values that comprise together sustainability. I'll then present the production methods or nuclear fuel cycles, the production method of nuclear energy, and finally, I will connect those values to the introduced production methods. So I will present an ex post analysis of nuclear energy production. Let me first tell you something about sustainability. We must first be very clear about the definition of sustainability. And in that definition, there are several values at stake. I argue that sustainability is to be considered as a moral value that consists of five other values. Each of these values has a temporal and a spatial dimension. Temporal relates to time, and spatial dimension relates to space. What are these values? In discussion on sustainability and ethics, the very first question that we need to answer is the question of sustaining what. I'll distinguish here between two different aspects. Sustainability could relate to the sustaining the environment and humankind's safety. As such, we talk about the environment, and we talk about the public health and safety. But sustainability could also relate to sustaining human well-being. There, I will discuss resource durability and the economic aspects of new technology. Again, each of these values will have a spatial and a temporal dimension. So this is how I would see sustainability. On the right side, you'll see the environmental friendliness, public health and safety, and security. Later in this presentation, I'll discuss why security is being discussed separately and separate from safety. On the left side in this picture, you see resource durability and economic viability. It is very important to also discuss the role of new technology, because new technology could change all these values and the relation they have towards each other. That part will be discussed in the second talk. Firstly, sustaining the environment, one of the first values I would like to discuss today. So the very first question that pops up here, why should we care about the environment? We distinguish here between two schools of thinking. That is anthropocentrism, the school of thinking that argues that the environment does not have a value as such, it could only have an instrumental value. So anthropocentrism means that human beings are being the center of attention in this analysis. And the second school of thinking is non-anthropocentrism, in which we argue that the environment has an intrinsic value as such. So it has a value that does not necessarily relate to what it means for human beings, hence non-anthropocentrism. The second important value is public health and safety. So this value says that we should not jeopardize the people's safety now and in the future. The question that pops up here is how far in the future should we care and should we offer protection? And this is a question that very much relates to tangible policy question. Let me give you an example. Here in the picture, you see the Yucca Mountain Repository, the world's first and biggest repository being built in the United States over the last couple of decades. So in introducing radiation standards in the Yucca Mountain Repository, the EPA, the Environmental Protection Agency in the US, presented several standards. So the EPA argued that for the next 10,000 years, we need to offer exactly the same level of protection for the people living in the next 10,000 years. That is 15 millirem per year. Rem is a unit for measuring health impact of radioactivity, or what we call radiotoxicity. In Europe, we worked with sievert, and sievert and rem are connected. So EPA argues the next 10,000 years, we need to offer exactly the same level of protection. But beyond that, a level of protection is offered that is much lower. So the first proposal was to have 350 milliram, and later, because of a lot of public debate, they adjusted that to 100 milliram per year. So beyond 10,000 years, we are offering you protection that is six times less than what we offer the present generation. So this again goes back to the fundamental question: how far in the future should we care, and how far in the future should we offer the same protection? The next issue is security. In nuclear energy discussions, we make a distinction between safety and security in the following sense. Safety is about unintentional harm, while security relates to intentional harm. When we discuss security, we talk about sabotage, the possibility of making a dirty bomb, for instance. We talk about non-proliferation, and non-proliferation again relates to manufacturing such a bomb, a device that could be used for destructive purposes, or the dissemination of the knowledge that could contribute to the manufacturing of such a bomb. So safety and security are two notions that are being discussed separately in nuclear energy discussions. The next value that relates to sustaining human well-being is the value of resource durability. So here we talk about the availability of natural resources. Durability is a very common understanding of sustainability. Of course, we cannot stop using non-renewable resources. So here the moral question at hand is, to what extent can we offer compensation for the resources that we have used and to which future generations will not have access? And the last value I want to discuss today is the value of economic viability. So for an energy source to be sustainable, it needs to be economically durable. So the moral question at hand here would be, durable for whom exactly? So whose interest is at stake, and whose interests do we need to take into account in our analysis? And again, the question would be, are future interests as important as the present ones? And if not, how do we value future interests compared to the current interest? In economic studies, the notion of discounting is being introduced here. So the value of future interest would be actually discounted for a certain percentage against the value of present. So discounting is a very important notion in a cost-benefit analysis, and discounting relates to the interest of future generations. Let me recapitulate the values that I introduced to you. I argued that there is the value of environmental friendliness, there is the value of safety, there is the value of security, and there is the value of economic viability. Each of these values has a spatial and a temporal dimension, and we could relate these values to the production of nuclear energy. Let me tell you something about nuclear energy production or nuclear fuel cycles. In this picture, you see actually two different fuel cycles that are common in the world. The black arrows are what we call the open fuel cycle. So mining and milling uranium and purifying and converting that uranium and enriching it, that means that we introduce uranium oxides, and the uranium oxide will pass through the nuclear reactor. What is coming out of the nuclear reactor is not called waste, it is spent fuel. Spent fuel could be considered as waste, which means that it needs to be disposed of underground for a period of 200,000 years to a million years. The black arrow represents the open fuel cycle of the type common in the US, in Sweden, and many other countries. However, spent fuel could also be recycled. The process of recycling spent fuel we call reprocessing. The greatest benefit of reprocessing is that the still usable material, uranium and plutonium, could be extracted and reinserted into the fuel cycle. A second very important benefit of recycling or reprocessing is that we could reduce the waste lifetime. However, reprocessing is a chemical process that also introduces waste. More importantly, plutonium extracted in the reprocessing process is the type of material that we could use for manufacturing a nuclear device. So reprocessing brings a very important security risk. For a detailed analysis of this table, you could look up the underlying paper in this lecture. But in short, we could relate each of these values to the underlying nuclear fuel cycles, the open and the closed cycle. So the argument presented here is that the open fuel cycle is particularly good for the present generations because it introduces the least burdens for the present generation. The closed fuel cycle, on the other hand, is best for future generations because it could help us reduce the waste lifetime for a very long time in the future, So we go from 200,000 years, the waste life of an open fuel cycle, to about 10,000 years, which is the waste lifetime of the closed fuel cycle. However, the closed fuel cycle brings various additional risks, being the security risk and also safety risk of the reprocessing plants for the present generation. Let me summarize the first talk. I argued that sustainability is best to be understood in terms of several moral values at hand and values that have a spatial and a temporal dimension. Those values are safety, security, economic viability, and resource durability. The fifth value that implicitly discussed here, also explicitly in the presentation, was the value of environmental friendliness that most relates to the safety issues. So when conceptualizing responsible innovation, we need to first have an ex post analysis of what is at stake, ethically speaking, and that we have discussed in case of a nuclear power production, a nuclear fuel cycle. So this ex post analysis is very interesting and important, and it's the first step that we need towards an ex ante analysis. That ex ante analysis will be presented to you in the next lecture. Thank you for your attention.